The views and comments expressed on the following radio program by its hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect the views of RMCOnAir.com or its affiliates. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome to the Hollywood and Vine Recovery Center Care for Kids broadcast. This is our first broadcast. We'll be on every Wednesday from 3 to 5. We hope you join us. I have with me Dr. Gloria Montgomery, the founder and executive director of Hollywood and Vine Recovery Center. And we are doing a Care for Kids event, and she's going to talk to you a little bit about that and tell you what we're about and talk about the video that you just saw.
Hi, Karen. I want to thank you for the introduction, and I'd like to speak to you about our Care for Kids program. We have found, doing research over the years, I've been involved in working in the treatment area for the past 55 years, and part of the problem that is so evident today that is being overlooked by the general public is that young people, kids from 17 to 8 years of age, is dying on the streets of the cities of our cities in L.A. and all around the country. These kids are dying from overdoses of drugs, and the number of drugs that they use, they use everything that they can get their hands on. And we have had young people as young as 8 years old that are suffering from this disease. And they don't offer very much care for children from 17 until and below. The treatment programs, the average child could not afford to get in them, although there's very few programs that will accept children. But the program's cost for the few that is there is from $50,000 a month, $4,000 to $50,000 a month. And this goes beyond the average family. They can't afford this type of treatment for their children. So that's left for the children to die in the hallways of businesses, in the alleyways, and underneath the viaduct, and all around. This disease is killing, and killing so many young people. We say, wake up, America. Wake up, adults, mothers, and fathers. We have the responsibility to offer these kids some services, but none is available. So at this time, I want to introduce Mr. Ricardo Appling, who's been working very close to us to help us to develop this program, where we're seeking to wake up people, wake up America, and don't allow your children to die. And he's been working to help us to manufacture that program that we're having, as Karen has said, June 2nd at the Avalon Theater in Hollywood in Vine. Rick, how have you saw this problem, and what do you think about what we can do to make a difference?
I think that the program that's set for June 2nd is fantastic. For number one, we have all the celebrities have been invited out. They're all coming out to talk to the children, talk to the kids. And, you know, if just one kid is saved, that's really great. But at this junction of what's getting ready to happen now with all these different celebrities coming out, I think it's going to help a lot of kids. It's going to help a lot of families. And, you know, we just need to talk about this problem because it's such a big problem. If you want to call and have a word with Dr. Montgomery here today, the number is 323-965-1600. 323-965-1600. The lines are open if you decide you would like to speak to Dr. Montgomery so she can explain to you the situation concerning this plague that's plagued all the children across the planet, drugs and alcohol. And it stems down to, if we don't deal with it today, tomorrow, it won't be no tomorrow. These kids are the future. So I like to say, call in 323-965-1600.
Thank you very much, Rick, because this problem is an epidemic. You know, more kids died last year from this disease than all of the military battles that our young soldiers have died in. There was over 140,000 people that died from overdose of drugs. And that don't count the number that has been in nursing homes where they have used drugs and they have stroked out, and in mental institutions where they have really lost the ability to function. So this is a wake-up call to America. Wake up. Don't sit back and let your children die. and the ghettos of the world. And the ghetto is not necessarily a street or a place. It's a state of mind. And that state of mind go all the way from Beverly Hills, from Bel Air to Skid Row and Compton. The problem is the same. The disease is the same as it affects all these young people's lives. And what we're having that day and what we're having right now starting is for you out there to pay attention, to donate money for this cause so that we can find facilities to provide treatment for these kids before it's too late. And how is some of the programs, what are some of the programs you see that's developing out there, Karen?
Well, we've got our own website up where you can donate from there, and there's other information on the site as well. Our website is www.HollywoodAndVineRecoveryCenter.com. We have a Facebook presence. It's facebook.com/HollywoodAndVineRecovery, and you can interact with us there. And we have some other links that are also available. We have a blog that you can go in, join in discussions with, and the blog spot is, I don't have that in front of me right now, but I'll get back to that in a second. But there's all the information is on our website. We talk about our kids being out there, and when we say our kids, we mean our American, worldwide, everywhere, our kids. Even if we don't physically have children, the children of America belong to us all, and because they're our future. And right now, we're looking at 6 in 10 high schools and 1 in 3 middle schools that are now drug infected. And that's private and public schools as of 2012. So no one is immune.
And we'd like to say a wake-up call to our White House, to our president, to
yes.
let you know about these kids that's on the street, kids that maybe you don't hear about because they don't have a voice of their own. And this is the silent population of America, your children dying on the streets of America.
The fact is, the major issue is with the children is that the parents, they can't really afford to do what needs to be done because they don't really know what to do. And they don't seem to be able to get the proper information, and so they just don't know how to deal with their kid. But the fact is, these drugs and alcohol, they get it somewhere, they get it in school, they get it out of the cabinets in your, you know, anywhere. It's just the stuff they're dying on the day, the statistics of it is just growing and growing. If you'd like to talk to Dr. Montgomery, call 323-965-1600.
And if you care, you can care and donate to this problem, Care for Kids. We will accept $10 to $10,000 because the need is so great. So don't sit back and say, I can't contribute because I don't have that much. We can't afford to wait till children die and have to bury them. So how about donating? We accept $10 up to $10,000 to help provide treatment facilities and programs to meet the needs of these young people in America today. And we like to do a shout out to Ms. Joan Wendoff, who is the assistant director of the Hollywood Vine Recovery Center, that she has faithfully been working there for the past 40 some years. And we want her to know that Ms. Wendoff and you out there, you sponsors, you donators, or you mothers and fathers who care, we like to donate this particular song to you.
Absolutely.
This is to you. every mother, every person who cares in America. These children need you. They need you today. They cry out for help today. And we want to know that you can be the wind beneath their wings.
Every mother, every father, every sister, every brother, anyone who cares about someone, they know they have a problem or are struggling with substance abuse, this is for you. We do care.
Today, we like to say that, and recently, we had a chance to talk to a mother who had just buried her child because she couldn't get her 16-year-old into any treatment program. And although they tried, they went everywhere to all different agencies, and they couldn't help. And so the only thing she could do was stand at the graveside of her child and watch that child die in this disease, because no one here seemed to care. But we're saying to those caring mothers, you are the wind beneath these children's lives, and we need you to respond. We need your help. We need you now.
If you'd like to call, talk to Dr. Gloria Montgomery. The number is 323-965-1600. 323-965-1600.
Mothers, fathers, your children are crying out for help today. They live in a dark place. They live in the shadows of our communities. And we need to let them know that we care, that we are the wings over these children's lives. We're the only place they could look to for help, and we have let them down. Please, please, whoever's out there, listen. They need your help.
Please come to our website, HollywoodandVineRecoveryCenter.com. All the information is there. Facebook as well, Facebook.com/HollywoodandVineRecovery. We really can make a difference, and we must make a difference.
We thank you for listening to our program today, Care for Kids. And we need each one of you to join, that each one of us can make a difference. We're asking whatever you have to help to reach out and spare some of these children's lives.
So please join us every Wednesday from 3 to 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on rmconair.com. Expect a miracle, Care for Kids, live radio and internet stream. You can find us online at HollywoodandVineRecoveryCenter.com or Facebook, and like us at Facebook, Facebook.com/HollywoodandVineRecovery. And you can also call in. Please call in. That call-in number, if you have any questions, concerns, any stories you'd like to share, this helps us all. We're not in this alone, and that's one of our points. We're not alone. We feel alone. You are not alone. Please call in 323-965-1600. We look forward to getting your calls.
As the snow flies on On a cold and gray Chicago morning, a poor little baby child is born in the ghetto. And his mama cries.
'Cause if there's one thing that she don't need, it's another hungry mouth to feed.
Don't you understand? The child needs a helping hand. He'll grow to be an angry old man someday. I take a look at you and me. Are we too blind to see? Do we simply turn our heads and look the other way? Well, the world turns.
And a hungry little boy with a red nose plays in the street as the cold wind blows in the ghetto.
And his hunger burns. So he starts to roam the streets at night, and he learns how to steal, and he learns how to fight in the ghetto. The young man breaks away. He buys a gun, steals a car, tries to run, but he don't get far. And his mama cries.
And his mama cries.
As the crowd gathers round, an angry young man face down in the street with a gun in his hand in the ghetto. And as her young man dies.
As a young
on a cold and gray Chicago morning, another little baby child was born in the ghetto. And his mama cried.
And his mama cries.
On a cold and
Chicago morning, another little baby child is born in the ghetto.
Okay, we're back, and hope you enjoyed that video that and the music. We have with Care for Kids event that's coming up. It's a red carpet, star-studded music extravaganza. And we are expecting IM5, Keisha Cole, Tasha Smith, Sheila E., Mike Panera of Iron Butterfly and the Blues Image, and the Classic Rock All-Stars, gospel legend SADA, which stands for Sisters Against Drugs and Alcohol. And we have many senior level executive music executives, such as Tony Mercedes.
We have also Judge Strong. Judge Craig Strong, and he's been on the Detroit Ricardus Court branch for over 30 years, and he has great interest in what is going on in the world today for our children. He realizes that they have to be an alternative to just putting them in juvenile facilities or putting them into jails around the country. He, too, is interested in finding solutions for these children. We also have Mr. Al Bell, who would be given a celebrity award for the career he has had in music, that he has helped young people develop their music over the years. He was the owner of Stax Record, and he was also the director or the producer of
Motown
Records, yeah. And he has opened his heart and opening his mind to reach out to help young people. He helps so many find their way in the entertainment industry. You name anyone that he's helped in their career. All of our celebrities today bow and give him thanks for the work he's done. But also, there's many, many others that's going to be on that program that we haven't time to bring you the full sheet, but come out on June 2nd to the Avalon Theater and join us in this celebration for the Care for Kids. Join us and donate so this event will be to celebrate their lives, help them to save lives, and this problem, this ghetto problem, the ghetto of the mind and spirit that's going on all around America today. We talk about the events that happen when there's a gun shooting in a school or in a church or in a facility, and America joins in the grief process of them. But nobody stands at the bedsides or at the gravesides of these children that's dying. Aren't they life just as valuable?
Yes, and it's we're expecting a great turnout. 1735 Vine Street is Club Avalon, the corner of Hollywood and Vine. And it's from 4 p.m. to 10 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Tickets go on sale April 1st. You can buy them at the box office or directly from Club Avalon. If you click on their site, you'll see our information. And again, we are really trying to partner with the community in raising awareness and help our kids. A lot of people may say, well, you know, they're kids. You're going to give them treatment, and they're going to go back and do the same things over and over.
Well, they think that children are getting treatment, and children are not getting treatment.
Absolutely.
Most facilities do not deal with young people under 18 years of age. There is no detox centers available for these kids. The only programs that they do have, and it's very few throughout the country, we did a nationwide study, and the only ones, they run $30,000 to $40,000 a month.
Some up to $150,000 a month.
And you know, that bypasses our middle class children, and it bypasses
98%
all of the others that die in this disease. We're honored to have with us today a young woman who is in a play, and the play is about Hattie McDaniel. Daniels, and I'm sure most of us can remember her. She was the first black woman to get an Oscar award, and we're so happy. What was that award? Well, we want to introduce Vicki Reynolds. She is the star that's in back of this program, that she has been in this role for quite a while. And if you get out there and see her, we were there the other night, and it was such a beautiful, heartwarming program that we went to her and asked her to please come out and tell you about what she's doing, because the world needs to know. And come out and join her at this play. She'll personally receive you and give you an autograph. Vicki, would you like to share?
Yes. It's called Hattie, What I Need You to Know, about Hattie McDaniel, who was the first African-American to win the Oscar for Mammy and Gone with the Wind.
Yes.
And
everybody mostly have saw that movie,
mm-hmm.
you
yes.
know, and recognize her, the acting that she did. But
well,
you,
she was a
that
phenomenal
we saw
woman.
The other night,
yes.
You did that role just as beautiful as she did.
Thank you.
You
so
need
much.
An award for what you're doing.
Thank you so much.
I think,
much.
Too, so many like me, we know that. We know how powerful she was in that mm-hmm. Role. And we wondered, especially during that time, you know, who was she? What was her background? What was, you know, where did she come from? How did she,
well, she,
you know,
she was,
we don't. You know, that information is not readily available.
Well, I was ignorant to who she was. My brother was Ron Richardson, a Tony Award winner for the play Big River.
Mm-hmm.
And he passed away in 1995.
Wow.
And he said to me, Vicki Lynn, you should do the life story of Hattie McDaniel. Mm-hmm. Well, I had an attitude, you know, because I thought she was a sellout to the race, and all she did was mammy and maid roles.
Right.
And then come to find out, Larry Riley, who was in the Soldier Story, he played guitar and sang in the Soldier Story, mm-hmm. and he was also the first black on the Knox Landing, the evening sitcom.
Right.
Yeah. Well, we were on the set of Polly. And he said to me, Vicki Lynn, come here, sit down. If nobody approaches you with the idea, if nobody writes it, you write it yourself, but you do the story of Hattie McDaniel.
Right.
And then he passed away. Mm. And I said, you know,
they left that heritage to you.
Yeah, I said, they're leaving me something, you know. Right. So I began to do research on her. And I did 3 years of research on her in Colorado, Washington, D.C., here in Los Angeles, mm-hmm. and New York.
Those mm-hmm. were the places she lived and worked.
Well, she lived in Denver, Colorado, but she worked, of course, in New York and mm-hmm. here, mm-hmm. you know. And, you know, they have archives over in Washington, too.
Right, right.
So after I started doing research on her, she was a phenomenal woman, a trailblazer.
Right.
You know, she was civil rights before we even knew about civil rights, you know.
Right.
A lot of people don't know that, you know, she went all the way to the Supreme Court to have the deeds changed.
Really?
Because she, you know, they weren't allowed to sell to Jews, Chinese, and African Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And she, along with co-defendants and Lauren Miller, her lawyer, and they were able to overturn that.
Wow, yeah. That's incredible.
That's how we can buy houses now today.
She right. made the way possible
yes.
so that we could live too.
Yes, absolutely.
Wherever we chose.
And, well.
And especially for actors, you know. She had to be phenomenal to win an award in 1939.
Right.
You know.
It was unheard of.
Unheard of.
And look how many years went by before another black actress was considered for that award.
Well, she was not just a black actress. She was the black, just first African-American, period.
Yes.
You know, then came Sidney Poitier mm-hmm. after her.
Right.
You know, and that was how many years later?
Yeah,
but it was a lot 60s. More years later before a woman was able to pick up that statuette and be represented.
Yes.
And listening to her when she received her Oscar, mm-hmm. she gave credit to Hattie mm-hmm. and said that we stand on the shoulders of those that have gone before us
mm-hmm.
and made the way possible mm-hmm. that we could stand here and be here today.
Absolutely.
She said, I stand for every African-American woman mm-hmm. out there today
mm-hmm.
and let them know that the way is possible.
Mm-hmm.
The race have been run
yes.
and now we're standing in to take the benefits.
Absolutely.
And that was so beautiful.
Absolutely.
And that lady that played that role,
mm-hmm.
do you recall her? One of the most beautiful women today, and she's featured in so many movies.
Well, she won for Best Actress. Halle Berry.
Halle Berry.
Yes.
She was the only one that received an award before her, the second woman to receive that award.
No, she was the third.
Third
Whoopi
woman?
Whoopi Goldberg was the first.
Oh, for Ghost.
Yeah. Yes, for
yes,
Ghost.
For
yes.
Ghost. Well, hers was a supporting role, wasn't
yes,
it?
Yes, she was supposed, mm-hmm. and so was Hattie. Hattie was supporting role.
Yeah.
Wow.
And
so Hattie
Whoopi,
to Whoopi.
Whoopi, yes.
yes. Yeah.
And then Hallie, she won for Best Actress.
Actress, yes.
And then Monique won for supporting
right,
role.
Right,
yes.
right,
yes.
right.
And those are the three women.
Wow.
Well, until this past year. We had for that book.
Octavia Spencer. Yes.
For the work, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Or, the maids. 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 Was
yeah,
it maids?
About
no,
the maids.
It was called the...
The Help.
The Help.
That's
help.
What it was called.
The Help.
Yeah.
yeah. We just
yeah.
watched that the other day.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
yeah.
That's a...
So you are back by popular demand.
Yes.
Vicki Lynn Reynolds.
Yes.
Yes. Hattie, What I Need You to Know. A musical play directed mm-hmm. by Byron Nora.
Yes.
Well, she had been sort of lost out of the consciousness of young people today.
Oh,
and we need to reawaken them
most
to
definitely.
Where we came from,
absolutely.
How long it took us to get there, And how absolutely. Few of us is recognized even today.
Oh, absolutely.
But think for women like you mm-hmm. that is making us aware, letting these young people know.
Well, that's the reason history. I wrote it as a play first. I've also, along with my partner Ron Main, written a feature film. Mm. But and I have spoken with the president of one of your major studios here in Hollywood, and he said, "Vicki, go. I can't get anyone interested in doing the movie. So go independent. Mm-hmm. You know, we're trying to go independent.
Okay.
But that my reason for writing the play was to introduce her mm-hmm. to young people
back.
Today.
Yes.
You know, to bring her yeah. back.
Mm-hmm.
Remember.
Well, yeah. What is the name of the theater over there?
And the Hudson Theater. That's
it's the Hudson Theater, Hudson. And you know what is the address of the Hudson Theater?
6539 Santa Monica Boulevard. It's east of Highland and west of Vine.
Mm-hmm. And how do you get tickets?
You get tickets from Plays 411. Mm-hmm. You can get them online at plays411.com/272366/Hattie.
And what is the hours of the play? I mean, what days and what hours is it? You start at March 8th, and it lasts to,
goes
it runs to
April 14th.
April the 14th.
Friday and Saturdays at 8, Sunday at 3 p.m.
Hmm.
You
okay.
can also call 323-960-5774.
And get more information on this play.
Yeah.
Well, it's our honor today to have her on our program and to let you know there is people that's concerned about what's going on with young people today.
Yes.
And they are dedicating the work they do to help young people to know that it's possible, that we don't have to die in alcohol or drugs.
Mm-hmm.
And we know these drugs are killing our young people.
Absolutely.
They're killing their mind, killing their spirit.
Mm-hmm.
They're losing hope.
Yes.
That the average is 51 children that drop out of school in before they get out of the 10th grade.
Yes.
51% drop out because they feel like
now.
They
yeah.
have lost their hope. They have lost the reasoning why they should finish. They say, what do you offer us?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we can't say, we can't speak to the future.
Mm-hmm.
We can only speak to now.
Yeah.
That now we can offer you a hand up and a way of life.
Mm-hmm. And it begs the question, if this is happening after 10th grade, you've got, it's getting closer to 60%
yeah.
that don't enter 11th grade, where are they going? Where are they going?
It's
what
very
are they
sad.
Doing?
It's very sad.
There's no jobs available.
Yeah.
And there's no, they can't afford if they even finish to get into colleges these days.
I mean, you know, college is like high school used to be. You know,
yes.
your mom used to say, you have to get your diploma. You have to get your diploma. Now
you need to go on to
college degree.
They yeah. said that one out of eight kids that go to college that has a BA degree,
mm-hmm.
that one out of eight can't even find employment.
That's right.
So now what hope is it for those kids that haven't even finished
graduated
mm-hmm. high school?
Mm-hmm.
So the only thing that they see, there is no hope, and they use drugs to escape the reality of their lives,
mm-hmm.
because where can we go? There's nowhere to go. And then they stand, and
well,
there's no
I mean,
hope.
The hope is God. You know, and that's our only hope.
But who's standing in the trenches talking to young people about this?
We as
well,
adults,
that's what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to step
we
up.
We need to step up.
Well,
you know,
we
stepped up.
It was okay. I think segregation hurt us.
Absolutely.
You know, it really hurt us because we used to be in our own community, the preacher, the teacher, the lawyer, the doctor. We all lived in the same community.
Yeah, but this problem is not only is it nationwide, it's worldwide.
Yeah.
And it affects kids no matter where you live,
all
different
cultures.
These private schools, you think sending your kid to a private school is a protection, but the private school and the public school equal up in 2012, mm-hmm. that they have the same problem as the schools that's supposed to be in the so-called ghettos. Mm-hmm. They have the same problem in private schools. So, you know, mothers and fathers need to wake up mm-hmm. and know what their children are doing. Mm-hmm. But some parents know and they don't know what to do.
Exactly.
They don't know where to find help.
Exactly.
We get calls daily from mothers mm-hmm. saying, what can I do? Mm-hmm. My daughter, she's using drugs and she's being used on the street mm-hmm. for drugs. And all of these things is happening to our children, and parents just stand there because they can't afford to get them in to get the help that they need. Mm. So, you know, yes, we all can do something. Mm-hmm. If nothing else, you know, take that $10 that you're going to eat at McDonald's with, or take that $10 that you're going to spend at the movies, mm-hmm. take that $10 and invest it in the life of your child.
Absolutely.
They talk about a mind is a terrible thing to lose. Mm-hmm. A child is a terrible thing to lose mm-hmm. here and, in America today.
And contrary to what a lot of people feel, that, you know, children don't want it, mm-hmm. they do. We get calls every day. Dr. Montgomery gets calls every day. They're looking for a way out. They're looking for guidance. They're looking for help. And their parents stand by idly because they don't have the financial support to put them into quality
treatment. And they don't know what to do.
Well, for one thing, we need to get sports and performing arts back in high school.
Yes, this is a big thing. The high schools have been
able to save us.
Well, we're talking about the dropout rate in high schools, and those kids that drop out, most of them drop out into drugs. Mm-hmm. And they said that 90% almost of all of our high schools are drug infected mm-hmm. places to go, and yet we have to
Idle Minds is a devil worship, and they don't have anything to do anymore.
Now,
you know, it's
even
that,
if they were in school after school, there's nowhere to go.
It's
this
nothing
is what
to even to
we need to
you know,
create.
You can't even say if you don't do a so and so, you can't go. You cannot play. You can't play football. You can't play basketball.
You can't go to
you don't
the
have
center.
Any, right.
You know. Yeah.
But
we're the ones.
We offer them nothing for their future unless we get busy today.
Yes. Absolutely.
At this time, we have to take a short break, but it's about the children.
Yes.
Hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up?
This is a big party, man.
Yeah, brother,
dig it.
There's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate.
You know we've got to find a way
to bring some love and get here today. Picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality.
Sister,
talk to me,
sister,
so you can see.
What's going on?
sticks out. Don't punish me with brutality. Come on, talk to me. You can't see what's going on.
We want to thank Vicki Lynn for coming out today and sharing with us. And we want you to hurry up over and get those tickets, because it's if you want to be able to get in, because it's been a sellout performance ever since it began in March. And it will close April the 14th. So come out on Friday or Saturday at 8 p.m. or Sunday at 3 p.m. And that's the Hudson Theater. And that's at 6539 Santa Monica Boulevard in Los Angeles. And we want you to come get your tickets now so that you'll be able to get in, because it was a standing room only crowd when we were there last week. And we really could not tell you, stress to you, how rich this play is and how history taken it is for us to learn about our roles in the movie industry and our roles in what's going on in the theaters today. And a lot of young kids out there, you haven't even had a chance to get to a theater. And Vicki Lynn says, if you young people that's under 14 come out, then she'll arrange for you all to be able to get in and see the play at a greater discount. So come out, bring the kids out. Some of them have never been able to go to a play, so come out and see them. So I want to thank you for being here. We'd like to have you back again and tell us about the play and your next move as far as the movie is concerned. Okay. We wish you a lot of success.
Thank you.
And Mr. Rick Ricardo, what's going on? And tell us about how you have been working with most of these artists that's coming out to be a part of the program and speak to these young people and encourage them and help them find a way. Because our music industry, our acting industry, it influenced more kids today than any other kind of influence, because this is what they do. They listen to music all day. They go to concerts, and those that can afford it, they just lost a part of their social development. Mm-hmm. And that's what happens here today. Mm-hmm. Drugs will steal your youth. It will steal your life. So, Ricky, I know you've been working with a lot of groups and performers, and I like to say that Ricky here is producing a play about Sammy Davis Jr., a movie about a feature film movie about Sammy Davis Jr. And he's another person that I hope don't get lost in the shadows of our growth by our youth, because he was the most greatest entertainer in the world.
Yes.
He was able to sing, dance, imitate people, played all of the instruments, and he was a gift to our country.
Yes,
he was a gift to our life.
Yeah. I just want to say that, you know, what's really going on with these kids, June 2nd, is what it's all about. You know, I mean, a lot of people out there got careers. They producers, they singers, they actors. You got to step up for these kids. I mean, you know, we know you all got your careers. God bless you. But I just want to say to you that, you know, you can't be selfish. I mean, I know you got money living in them big mansions and all that. That's good. I've been there, you know, on my way back. So, but anyway, my only point I'm saying is, you can't forget these kids. I mean, June
2nd. And everybody is affected. Don't think you could afford to look the other way.
Yeah.
It's your child, or it's your relative's child,
niece,
or your neighbor's child.
Absolutely.
It affects all of us here in America.
Right.
There's nowhere we can avoid knowing this problem exists. We bypass it, act like we don't see it.
Right.
But it's there.
It's there.
And we can't hide it.
You got to realize Obama. Let's look at Obama. He in the White House. His wife is, too. They got somebody in their family that's got a problem. Mm-hmm. The problem's in all families. You know, that's I'm not just saying Obama. I'm just saying that to say there's a problem in everybody's family. And, you know, everybody need help. So you got to pull together. All the celebrities I talk to, they don't have a problem coming out June 2nd just to talk to these kids. And I think that's great. And any celebrities out there, if you hear me today, come out June 2nd. It's going to be a great affair. It's all about the kids. I mean, it's not about anything, but we need you to come out and talk to kids. But Dr. Montgomery's just been working so hard in the field of drugs and alcohol. She has the information you all might need to open some doors to help some kids. If you'd like to speak to her right now, call 323-965-1600. That's 323-965-1600. And she can give you some information that might help your kid at home or your neighbor's kid or somebody. All kids out there know some other kids that need help. It's all about helping these kids.
And I just want to say, let's step up. It's all about helping today, because this child, these children, may not be here tomorrow. So we need your help now. So we're asking you to look at our website and look at our care page, and we ask that you donate whatever you can, you know, to help these young people. And we're speaking to some sponsors out there, you know, we grew from our children being a part of our lives. What's going to happen in 10 years, 20 years? Who will run the country? We're coming into a state of silence and change, radical change, because the children, unless they're treated today, there won't be a tomorrow for them. And again, you know, this affects all of our lives, because maybe you living in your big house and you feel smug and comfortable, but you know, kids out there influence other kids.
Absolutely.
And these peer groups is getting, your kid is going to school, they're being pressured into using drugs.
Absolutely.
And everywhere they look in these schools and in the neighborhoods and wherever they are, there's drug use going on.
Mm-hmm.
And these kids is just not stopping. They talk about marijuana being a gateway to other drugs. Mm-hmm. Marijuana is a drug in itself that's causing, that have killed a lot of young people.
Mm-hmm.
And they've overdosed thinking they can't on marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
But the marijuana leads them to other drugs. There's drugs on the street that you never even heard of before.
Mm-hmm.
That bath sauce is a new drug.
Mm-hmm.
And that new drug, it's not under any kind of legal problem. You can go in the drugstore and get it. You can go into any of the little shops around and buy that drug.
Well,
and that drug is killing
people. They're doing helium, you know, from the balloons.
Yes.
The helium and... It's just, there's even a newer homemade drug. I can't think of the name of it.
But
they do it one time, it can kill you.
The salt drug
mm-hmm.
is that bath salts have caused people to eat the flesh of other people.
Oh,
it's so severe.
Salt.
It has cost, in just one use of it, here was a doctor and his wife, both of them were doctors, and they had the young son that was in college and doing well, and he went out with his friends one time and tried bath salts, and the next day, he cut his throat from ear to ear, and by his parents being doctors, they rushed him to a hospital, and they got him taken care of, and they took him home, and then while they were both holding and watching him, he slipped out of their care and went into his bedroom and blew his brains out.
Lord.
From one time using bath salts. And the boy said in his dying, he said, you know, it's not a drug to get high on. It's a drug that would create schizophrenia, and it's a death drug. And he warned people about the death drug that we got out there. You could buy it in drugstores. You could buy it anywhere. So I'm saying, and there is no 12-step programs for these children.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, a lot of adults, they have 12-step programs they can go to for support groups.
Mm-hmm.
But this drug that these young people are on, there is no model of no 12-step program that they could go to.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no help available. They can't go to, they don't fit into, say, AA or NA model. Mm-hmm. They're using, like you say, from balloons to a young lady that was an honor student in school 2 days ago. They had to bury her because
elementary
she was
school.
Huffing.
Elementary school.
And she was huffing. That huffing is what you do to these drugs. You inhale them and you huff them, and it killed her. Mm. And she was home alone. When her parents came in, they found her body. And she was an honor student at one of our local schools here in the Valley.
And there are things about the what they call the spice. Kids think they're smoking marijuana, and it's completely synthetic. And it does not have an antipsychotic in it that some of the other things that they smoke does. Mm-hmm. And it does cause schizophrenia. They start hearing voices. They are, you know, they just, it makes them crazy. Oh. It absolutely makes them crazy. And sometimes it's permanent. And one of the questions I had was, what are our kids running from? How are they, this is 12, 13, you know, 7, 8-year-olds. What are they running from? What are they hurting so much about that they're checking out at such a young age? And by the
like I said, idle minds. You know, they don't have anything.
Well, actually, there's no parent support.
Yes.
Because nowadays, if a parent have a job, they had to work two jobs to be able to support just the normal bills, just the rent, and put food on the table. Mm-hmm. And children are left alone a lot. Television has been the babysitter.
Right, yeah.
And now these children,
they
feel lost, and they feel and they on their own. Mm-hmm. So they get out and get involved with children in their school.
Mm-hmm.
They're pressured into these groups. And then they start using drugs, and there is no out for it. Mm-hmm. And when some parents try to ignore this problem, think it doesn't exist in my child. And if my child is those other kids out there that's making my child do this, we always want to look to someone else rather than taking the responsibility and knowing that it was the life of my child. And I'm saying, don't wait till it's too late to be concerned about this. We need to be concerned about this right now. And we like to send a shout out to the White House and tell them, you know, it's nice to create drug treatment programs out of a book or out of a study, but we're saying, come on down to the street and see where the real problem is. Come on down and walk the avenue of some of your streets. Anywhere in America, you will find kids that's living under bridges and viaducts. You will find kids that's they don't run away. They have no place else to go but to the street. And you find them in assembled in these places using drugs.
Doorways.
And our children, you worry about all kind of problems, but the problem of prostitution today is 12-year-old girls prostituting themselves out for drugs. And so parent, where were you when your kid died?
Mm-hmm.
Where were you when they was crying out for help? Where were you looking the other way? And when someone else came and took your child away from you and put him into drugs and into prostitution and later into death,
where were
you? We at this time would like to take a break and go back to the song we had previous is What's Going On, but now we want to turn back to our song of what this drug is doing to kids' life. Look at the video as we share it in our song. Or let's hear what's next. And we want you to listen. Listen. Your child's life is at stake. You can't look the other way. It's about them and it's about you. We have failed our children. We have robbed them of their lives, their youth, and we robbed them of their future. They're dying too young.
There'll come a time when the world won't be singing, when the world won't be singing. Flowers won't grow, flowers won't grow, no. Bells won't be ringing,
no bells won't be ringing.
Who really cares?
Who really cares?
Who's willing to try?
Who is willing to try
to save a world?
To save a world
that's destined to die.
That is destined to die.
When I look at the world,
when I look at the world,
it fills me with sorrow.
It fills me with sorrow.
Little children today,
children today,
really gonna suffer tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Oh,
what a shame.
What a shame.
Such a bad way to
such
live.
Such a bad way to live.
Oh, who is to blame?
Who is to blame?
We can't stop
when
living.
We can't stop living. Oh,
live.
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 Live for life.
Live for life. But let live, everybody.
Live life for the children.
Live life for the children. Oh, for the children.
You see, let's save the children. Let's save all the children.
Save the babies. Save the babies. And if you want them, you got them. Save the babies. Oh, don't fear. You got them. You will save the babies. All of the children. But who really cares?
So again, we want to encourage you to please support, come out, and participate in the Hollywood and Vine Recovery Center's Care for Kids, June 2nd from 4 p.m. to 10 p.m. at Club Avalon. It's at the corner of Hollywood and Vine. And we are raising money to cover the skyrocketing costs of substance abuse treatment that is now financially out of reach to most kids suffering with substance abuse. And we hope that you will take this seriously. It's not going away. It's not going down. It's going up. And it's going up at alarming rates. It is a nationwide crisis. And we have undertaken this project. We hope that others will follow in our footsteps. And
more children died last year from drugs than all the wars that we have fought for freedom. And yet our children are not free on the streets. So we ask you to please, what is it?
We have a the Care donation fund. Website you can go to directly. It's www.gofundme.com/HWAVRC-musical-event. That's available on our website as well. But the HWAVRC stands for Hollywood and Vine Recovery Center. So I'll read it again. It's www.gofundme.com/HWAVRC-musical-event.
And we have that name, GoFundMe. It came from children that were sick in this disease, and they were begging America, GoFundMe, help me before it's too late. We have with us a young man who has did remarkable work and trying to find and help these young people and bring them into treatment. You know, sometimes it's a lonely job because you're out there all by yourself sometimes trying to talk with and encourage these children to come and get help. And after you encourage them, there's nowhere for them to go. They can't even go. There is no 12-step support meetings for these children. So they are out there dying alone in the streets. And I'd like to introduce Andre at this time. And Andre, tell us about the work you've been doing with the Hollywood Vine Recovery Center and with this Care for Kids.
Well, we've been putting the event together on June 2nd at the Avalon in Hollywood, California. We want to build group homes for these youths that do not have a place to go, that are homeless, that cannot afford treatment. And we want to do this as soon as possible. We want to open a youth home up in every city in California, starting with California, and then we're going to make it nationwide. That's what we want to do.
Now we need to, there's children everywhere. And like we were talking about in the ghetto, the ghetto is a state of mind. It's not just a location, it's a state of mind. And that state of mind affects young people from Bel Air, Beverly Hills, to Skid Row, to Compton, and to whatever Skid Row area you may have on your street. Realize that it's a Skid Row of the mind. These children have nowhere to go. The parents don't understand the nature of the disease, and those that try to seek help, they can find none because there's nothing available for them. Andre, how did you find this problem as you walked the streets and talked to young people and tried to encourage them into a better life?
And tell us your age.
My age is, I'm 23 years old, and I find that, you know, people don't, some people don't, how would you put it? They don't have the advantage to know what financial aid is, know what different things is. We wanna bring it to the kids' attention.
But there isn't really any financial aid for them. That's the sad part, that there's no one that says, I'll fund you.
Right.
So that's why we have fund you for kids.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Some people don't even know how to enroll in college.
They don't even get out of high school.
Exactly. So this is what we want to teach all of the children, as many as we can. So this is what we're doing this event for, and we want to start opening up these homes as soon as possible.
And we also have a young lady here with us, you know, and the kid that died from an overdose of drugs was part of her school system that she was in.
Uh-huh.
And here she is today because she's been interested in developing and helping young people. She just had a birthday. And how old were you on your birthday?
12
years old. But, you know, what made you feel the need to reach out and help these young people and talk about some of the things that have affected them?
It's because the girl in Nobel who died from, like, sniffing air freshener and stuff like that. And
she died from sniffing air freshener in her home. You know, the weapons of death is right in your own bathroom, in your own kitchen. And yet these kids is such a low state of mind that they feel the need to do these things, to escape from whatever it is. But as you talk to young kids and you see young kids, what do you think some of the problems come from?
Like my friend William, I think he just tries to act bad because somebody in his family is being mean to him. And one day, he brought like one of those water vapor cigarettes mm-hmm. to school, and then he started to smoke them and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, they see there's so much of this stuff around because the adults in their life is using drugs now. And they have not built a foundation for young people to have something to reach out to because their parents are doing these drugs, or either the parent is a single home parent holding on to a job just to be able to provide food on the table for their kids. and they can't find anywhere to get these kids help. And even those that can afford insurance, insurances do not cover treatment programs. They may, some of them, they don't cover children in any kind of detox facility or children program. So what do you think that these children, what is you think that hurt them the most? What do you see as the greatest problem with young people today, your age?
For me, since I went through it, it's because of my mom. She was using it, then we would never be able to find her because she was always on the streets using, and now she's in jail because she got in a car crash and hurt some people.
Mm-hmm. That's so sad, and that leave you, and, you know, wonderful that you had grandparents and sisters and relatives that you didn't have to be alone in this, but mm-hmm. so many children face the same problem you face, but they're alone out there. It's sad because you find 10, 11-year-old children ahead of a household because the parent is addicted to drugs to such an extent that the child has to run the house and take care of the younger children. Mm-hmm. And that's very common. But we know we're glad to see that you want to do something to help other people because you know what it feels like to be left or an abandoned by a parent. And so I'm so happy that you're willing to come and share with us. And is there something you like to say to a young person out there that might be listening and not know what to do? Is there something 11-year-old can tell them?
I would like to say to my friend Peyton Zoe Blanks, because right now her dad's in Baltimore and her mom is really trying to work hard for her. And every single time when I ask her to spend a night, she is like really grateful because she feels like you are also her grandmother and our, and she's also a part of our family.
That's wonderful. That's because of your loving spirit.
Yeah.
That you reach out and you embrace other children, you know. And so would you like to say to other children out there, don't give up hope?
Sure. Just, like, make sure that you kids out there do not, like, use drugs or else you're going to screw up your whole life.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Well said.
Mm-hmm. And tell them if they're having a problem, go to some adult that's not using drugs and try to ask them for help so that we can identify where these children are so that we could reach out and embrace them.
You know, it's interesting that you mentioned cigarettes because in Columbia University's 2012 national survey, they do it every year, they said this year drugs are more popular than cigarettes among high school students. And on average, 47% drink alcohol and 40% use drugs, including prescription drugs.
Even in elementary school, this is a problem.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We've got to reach in and reach back and pull
it's
them out.
Sad what's going on for the children or with the children. And I know out of your allowance, you're going to put that $10 in to help the Care for Kids Fund. Help them to have a better life. And I thank you so much for taking the time and the willingness to come out and share with us today. We want to thank you.
You're welcome.
Again, our call-in number is 323-965-1600. If you are a child, if you know someone, if you're a parent, if you have a question, a comment, please call us. Dr. Montgomery has a wealth of over 50 years of experience in this field, and it's a very unique experience to be able to get to her directly. And we're here to help. So.
We're happy to introduce one of our young people, a beautiful young lady that's here with us today, that have been walking and running with us in this pursuit of helping these young kids. And we're so happy to know she's a devoted mother, and she knows how it feels to possibly lose children in this disease, and she's out to share with us today. Janet, would you like to talk to us and tell us about this?
Yes. I think that it's wonderful that there is the awareness going out there, and there are parents and people who are willing to help, because it is so heart-wrenching to see these children out there dying of this disease. And I wish there would have been something like this when I was younger, mm-hmm. because by the time I was 13, I was pretty much a drug addict, and maybe I wouldn't have made some of the bad choices that I've made in my lifetime. And, you know, some of these have led me into ICU, resuscitated 3 times, and I made decisions that were, you know, I never would have in my normal state of mind. So the awareness to be out there and to start when you're young can make a huge difference in so many people's life, because, or lives. Because one child, to save one child, affects so many different people, because there's a brother and a sister out there, a mother, father, aunts, uncles. So it's really a domino effect. And to get the awareness out there is just so awesome.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yes, mm-hmm. it is.
Yeah.
And like you say, it's a disease that affects us all. And, you know, like you said, at 13 years of age, you felt that you were a drug addict because of being introduced to drugs through the school systems and around. You know what? If we would pay attention today, maybe it would take down the cost of young people as they grow older ending up into institutions like prisons and drug programs, programs for children to problem children, to keep them in group homes and things of this nature. And maybe it would cut down on that cost of operating prisons if over 90% of the people they claim in prison today has some drug-related problem.
Yes.
And that if we had reached that 90% before that happened, look how the cost of drugs have cost this nation. You know,
we may
the cost
have had
of
a cure for cancer.
Mental institutions have cost this nation with children ending up in mental institutions. And now you go to nursing homes, you find more young people in nursing homes than you do older people because of the damage the drugs have done to their brain and to their body, that they end up into these facilities. And that video we just played, one of those people have died from this disease since we developed this video. Mothers, fathers, America, wake up. We have with us another gentleman who has used music as his way of communicating with young people, that he go around to parks and all of these places where these young people are gathered together and using, and he talk with them and play music for them and encourage them if he can to find help. And then after he encourages them, then there's no help available to send them to. But his, we call him Music Man, because his music, music is a universal language, and it touches the heart. So how about talking to us, Dexter, about what you do?
Dexter, you know, we really don't get much of a vote what year we show up in L.A. I showed up in 1938, and that put me out of high school in 56, and I was honored enough to be able to go to high school and graduate from the band. Mother in 10th grade told me to go play a clarinet because she wanted to learn how to do the Charleston, and she invited me to help her, and we both got the job. I got the clarinet, and she got the Arthur Murray job, and I've been playing my clarinet since 1948, and I love my clarinet. I love Sidney Bouchet and Benny Goodman and all the beautiful people that's walked before me and that's coming after me. But I'm worried about the kids. Who's going to replace me after I'm gone, for Pete's sake? I'm looking for new band members, but there's nobody that wants to spend the time to do the Fingerchart, the clarinet. The clarinet is so lovely, and so is tuba and bass violin. But if you gotta, you can't be doing drugs and alcohol to be a music lover and to put the time into developing the love of creating the extension of the human voice. And I was honored to be able to walk those steps. And now I don't see many people being able to replace me. I'm looking for band members, but there ain't none getting in line. The schools are cutting off music, and most of the people aren't even graduating from school. And who's going to sing the songs of love in that next generation? Mm-hmm. I'm honored to have a grandchild that's going to be from the graduating class of 2030. Now, who's going to be? Who's going to play for him? He might be a coal miner. He might be a computer guy like his dad. But we need love in our country, and we're not showing enough of it.
And like you're saying, it'd be sad the day that the music died.
Mm-hmm. You know, not a sound.
And that's where we're going with the next generation. Because actually we're losing so many young people at such a tremendous rate that who will be there when the music dies?
And nobody. It's interesting you talk about the music and the power of music, and a lot of what our young kids are hearing through the music, unfortunately, is believed as the way to go in the negative, you know, the negative side. But there's a lot of good music out there.
Mm.
And a lot of things these young kids are hearing as lifestyles are simply hype. It's media hype to sell records. And the reality is that these kids that are believing this and doing drugs and being influenced by it, they end up where everyone does when they get involved with substance abuse. It's jails, institutions, and eventually death. And if we can catch them when they're young enough and they want the help, they have nowhere to go. We've stripped them of a lot of resources. We need to build back up those resources and put our hand out and make sure that we're known.
Well, maybe while we're building the music back, let's build the child back.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You know, our playgrounds are empty, or they're being used as a place you can go to use drugs.
And deal
our
drugs.
Our parks are filled with young people using drugs. So, you know, it's a tremendous problem in America today. And let's not continue to look the other way. Let's take the responsibility for our children. Let's. Okay. We have a call coming in.
Hello.
Hello, this is Dr. Montgomery.
Yes, Dr. Montgomery, I was giving a call and I was hearing some great things that you're over talking about. And I was just wondering, the one the young lady said she got high at 13. I know these kids out here, everybody gets high at different ages. At 13, was that an experience? I just like to know from her at 13, did that cause her whole life to be high from that point on?
Well, you know what we have been producing in our country lately? We're producing children that's 13, 14 years old that are having children. And then children trying to raise children is such a problem in America today. So we just like to say to you, wherever you are, keep reaching out and keep trying to draw in these young people to get the help they need.
So what is the event going to be?
The event is it's June the 2nd, and it's for children. It's the Hollywood and Vine presents a musical extravaganza with some of the greatest artists in the music field and the acting field that's coming out to join us in this great event. And it's going to be at the Avalon Theater or Club that's on Hollywood and Vine. And we'd like to extend an invitation to anyone out there who want to help. But we also want you the life you save could be your own child. We ask that you reach out and help with this situation. Call the funding program for kids. $10 to $10,000, whatever you have, can be of service.
For $10 donation?
Yes, $10 donation is needed.
What do I drop it off at Hollywood Vine?
You could either drop it off there, or you could actually use our site on what is the website that they can.
It's www.gofundme.com/HWAVRC-musical-event.
Could I just pay with my credit card? Could I do that?
Yes,
you don't have to leave your home to do this. You can do it right there where you are. And we like to say to those people that's driving today, going backwards and forwards to the few jobs that's available, but you out there, you can take time. It only take a minute to go to that fund and drop off something that will help the children. You know, we spend millions, billions of dollars building prisons to house our children in. Why don't we take just a small percentage of that and help to build a child's life rather than building more jails,
yes,
more
indeed.
Institutions, more schools that are not functioning? We need to do something different to help. And we thank you so much for calling in.
Yes, and I'd like to also mention that 100% of the proceeds that we raise through GoFundMe is going to go to what we call soberships. They're like scholarships, grants, you know, disseminated on an individual basis for kids who are trying to get into substance abuse recovery and get help and who need resources. So we are committed. We are 100% committed.
It's all about and all for the children. I know today that Rick, that you have some guests that come to join us, and we welcome them and welcome their presence here. So Rick, why don't you tell us something about what's going on?
Rick?
Well, it's Andre. All right, Andre, tell us about what's going on.
Thank you.
So here we have some children that are they're with us here. They're interested in helping the children. Why don't you guys come over and tell us about what you guys do?
Just pull up another chair for them. Mm-hmm. Pull up some chairs. Well, we don't need them on.
Right.
Only when the music is or the telephone is. Okay. How about introducing the guys that's in your group?
Well, my name is Jermaine. They call me Jay. I'm from Left Coast Longboarding.
Well, hi, Jay.
My name is Evan. I'm also a member of Left Coast Longboarding.
My name is Brian. I am, too, a Left Coast Longboarder.
What is Left Coast Longboarding?
Yeah.
What is that?
I had the idea, me and my cousin. We were, you know, kind of troubled youth on the streets. And, you know, I gangbanged for 17 years. You know, I'm 33 right now. And, you know, I changed my life, you know, and I feel like I took a lot from the streets. So, you know, I had an idea saying, you know, why I can't give back to the streets by, you know, teaching kids, you know, how to longboard, you know. Mm-hmm. Basically what our genre is, we're a push culture. It's basically all positive coming up out of longboarding. You know, you get positive energy, positive thoughts, and, you know, you can learn a lot from, you know, other people longboarding.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we're the first longboarding crew from South Central, so we wanted to just, you know, press it out there, you know.
Introduce the rest of the group.
I'm Ryan, aspiring Left Coast Walk longboarder.
Okay.
I'm Madeline, just a
normal skater, you know, hang out with my friends, you know. But I'm not from Long Coast because I do street skateboarding.
Okay. Here. And we have our first lady from Left Coast.
Oh,
her name is
welcome.
Anna.
Welcome. Tell us a little bit about it.
Well,
come on up and introduce yourself. Get on the mic and
that's
on the table. Sorry.
Introduce you right here.
Yeah.
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 Come on up.
I'll just put it right there. So, basically,
what was your name again?
Anna.
Anna. Anna, what made you make the decision to want to do this and become a part of it?
I wanted to do something positive, and I wanted to teach other people to be positive.
Well, what motivated you to want to reach out and help other young people? What was the motivation? Because I think this is great, and we want to know more about this, and we'd like to invite you all to our event June 2nd that's going to be at the Avalon Theater.
All right.
We're having a celebrity event there, and you guys are celebrities. You out there doing something every day to help somebody. So talk to us and tell us what made you feel like you wanted to do this. How was your life going prior?
Brian, what made you want to do this?
That's it. You've learned how to pass the buck already.
What made me want to do this? Well, I recently had like lost my family, and so it's like I wanted to find something to do. I'm a musician, but I haven't been able to get to the technology that I need to make the music that I want to make.
What kind of music you want to make?
I'm a rapper, and I sing.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're getting to be a part of a musical family here. This is what we're doing.
Well, we actually have quite a movement going. We actually have, like, musicians within the longboarding group. Like, I also have it's a street team called SWERVE. It's an acronym for Success, Wealth, Entertainment, Righteousness, Vigilance, and Empowerment.
That sounds wonderful. We'd like to hear a lot more about you and your work and what your plans are, your future plans. Well, one of the people that's on our program that's working with us, I don't know if you heard of Al Bell, but Al Bell owned Stack Records, and he was the president of Motown Records.
Oh, wow.
And
all right.
He is working with us, and he's always looking for talent. And he's interested in helping to promote and help young people to move on in this industry. And he's willing to help the talent develop, you know. You don't have to start at the top. You can grow into what you want to do. Mm-hmm. And you got these people that would mentor you into doing that. And Al Bell is just one of them, but we have a whole slew of people in the music field that is going to be there June the 2nd. But we want to talk more with you all, work with you all, and make you a part of that event. And if you get your music together, you can perform at that event.
Well, sounds good.
All right.
Can you do something a cappella?
And we got Snoop Dogg and them coming too, so maybe you might like that.
Okay, well, all right, let me, you know, he's on up in the camera. All right, let's see, let me dig deep into my inventory.
While you're looking, I want to ask him, which one say you lost your family? What happened?
Well, when I was 17, my mother passed away from cardiac arrest. I was just coming home from school, and it was like something already felt off, and so, like, right when I sit down on the couch, I was just about to turn the TV on and everything, the phone rings, and it's a lady at the ER. She said that my mom needed family right now, and is there any way that I can come? We tried to get in touch with my brother. My brother's phone was off, so we decided to call my mom's best friend. Her name's Katie O'Kelly. She came and picked me up, took me over to the hospital, and put us in this waiting room. That's when the doctor came in, and he didn't really beat around the bush. I guess I'm kind of glad he didn't. I wanted to be ripped off like a Band-Aid, rip it off quick, or else it'd be like painful. Don't beat around the bush, you feel me? Mm-hmm. And he says, Your mother was on the bus at 12 o'clock this afternoon. She went into cardiac arrest. Your mother is dead. And at first it kind of felt like a dream. Like, no, this couldn't be real. I'm about to wake up at any second. Then it really like set in. I'm like, okay. And it's actually a funny story. When we were leaving the hospital, an incident happened with the bus that actually made me think of her. See, my mom, when she wants to get your attention, she will try anything and everything to get your attention. Anything and everything. So we're pulling out of Cedar Sinai Hospital. We're coming up past the Beverly Center, and all of a sudden we hear a bus, like the bus horn just go off. And the bus driver pulls up next to us. He's not even holding the wheel or anything. The bus is just doing it itself. Hmm. And her thought, the thought of her, the image of her just popped up in my head. So it's like,
you were saying goodbye.
Yeah, that's what it felt like to me. So I guess I was more at peace with that. But just recently, I went to Reno, Nevada, which is where my dad lived. I went to his memorial service. He passed away from a stroke. So like, I'm 21 years old, about to be 22. But it's like, I wish I had more of a relationship with my father than I did. Like, I didn't get to see him that much ever since he moved to Reno. He moved when I was like 11. He got a job. He was actually a really, really good reporter. He worked as a Hollywood reporter on the red carpet, all of that, got all the best questions out. Mm-hmm. And he moved up to Reno because they basically just offered him a job as the top reporter. Mm-hmm. Like, that's basically what happened. So he had a good life. Mm-hmm. People loved him. People cared for him.
Well, and we understand how you felt. And what, you've been on your own pretty much since then?
Yeah. No, I've had family. I got my brother, Jordan Pearson, my brother. It's my older brother.
And you
right
got
there.
Some brothers here.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, actually, I'm about to meet him.
We all are family. We are our family.
Well, how about what happened with you?
I'm just, you know, I've known these two guys right here for 10 years. I just did a year of college and moved back because I went to Pennsylvania to Edinburgh University. And then I just didn't work out. It was too much money because I lived with my mom as a single mother for most of my life. And this guy right now, he ain't going to be on his own because I'm right now about to try to get us an apartment so he can do his thing because it'll be right by SMC, Santa Monica College, which is one of the best transfer schools in LA. Okay. And I wanted to help him out because I knew about his story. So he's like my brother right here too.
Well, we want to thank you, young man. Tell us about yourself.
Well, I'm Madden, 18, I'm from around that area.
Come to the mic.
Did they hear that? Yeah. Hey, let me sit down though. So I'm Madden. So I'm from around that area. You know, they're my friends. I see them around the time. I skate. I'm from like, I was born and raised in Venice with my mom and my dad, but we moved like a couple of years ago from over there because my mom, like, there was a shootout outside my house and we were all sleeping, and my mom, like, a bullet came in through the window, and my mom was up by that time. It was around like 4 in the morning, and like, it didn't hit her in the head, but it scraped her, you know, but it was pretty deep. So she was like in a coma for like 4 years. You know, and like, I feel like when she got out, she wasn't the same, you know, she's like worried. But I mean, I know how she feels because that's how everybody feels, you know. I feel mm-hmm. worried sometimes, you know.
You know, I really enjoy your sharing, all of you, but we're almost running out of time.
All right.
But don't think that your visit was in vain, because we like to talk more with each one of you. And we like to hear some of that music you talk about.
Okay.
And you can count on that you'll be a part of that June 2nd show. Okay.
All right,
we guarantee you that. All right. So I know that Andre is you. Where is he hiding? Okay.
I mean, if you're running short on time, I can always wait till next time.
Okay. Well, we look forward to you, and you are a blessing. This is what we want to do, to find young people who can get up. You know, life may knock you down, but you don't have to stay down.
Yes.
You can get up and have a life. And you all would be great encouragement to any of the young people we're talking about. And we'll have you meeting so many of these young people during this event that I'm sure some of them would like to join and find out what you're doing and make it a part of their life.
We have a website. Sorry to cut you off.
What is your website?
We have a website. We had Left Coast Longboarding at Facebook.com, Twitter.com. We have all events for kids. We have skate clinics to teach kids how to longboard. You know, instead of, you know, going to gangs, you can hop on the longboard and, you know, teach others how to longboard. It's Left Coast Longboarding at Twitter.com, Left Coast Longboarding at Facebook.com. We have all events, and we're trying to.
Do you have a telephone number that maybe they can call?
Yes, you can contact at us 323-283-4681, and you can. And my name is Jay. You can contact me. We make boards. We do custom longboarding designs, and we teach your kids how to longboard. And we're trying to get it for L.A. City Hall to have us to where we can have a skate jam in the middle of downtown Los Angeles to teach the kids how to.
And I'm sure, you know, with all of this, the property they got down there that's not being used, some of the school area that's not being used, I'm quite sure our new mayor would be interested in taking an interest in seeing these young people and seeing what they're doing. And these young people got the backing of so many others that will be working with them. You want to say something before we close about how these young kids and you run into each other to be here today? Don't take too long. We'll be off the air.
Yeah, these are my friends, my newly friends. And they're here, and they're going to help us with the event. What's the name of your group?
Left Coast Longboarding.
Absolutely, so look out for them.
What's the name of the group?
Left Coast Longboarding.
You got that out there.
You got that out there. So they're going to be at the event also on June 2nd. So everybody, please come out, visit the website, HollywoodAndVineRecoveryCenter.com. Everyone visit the website, donate, and everyone come to the event. Thank you.
Well, how about us playing that theme song we had for young people? You know, we want to thank the Jackson family for allowing us the privilege of playing Michael's record. They don't care about us. But we want to also say that meeting these young people today, there's young people out there that care about each other, that they want to help. And we welcome them to our team. So can we go to Michael?
Don't you?